Welcome back, everybody. Now that we've talked quite a bit about the logic of power analysis, and we've talked about different factors that affect statistical power, now we're ready to compute our first power analyses. In this video, we're going to learn about an a priori power analysis and also a post hoc power analysis. Let's jump right in and get started. I mentioned previously that we're going to learn about two different types of power analyses. In this video, for both of those analyses, we'll focus on the one sample t-test. You might remember this example right here. This was an example that we went through when we were originally learning about the one sample t. In this example, we learned that a cold medication statistically significantly slows people's reaction times. So it's probably unsafe to take that medication if you're planning on driving. Well, you can see this study already took place. We already collected the data. We already analyzed the data. So what we can do at this point is what we call a post hoc power analysis. In other words, we can figure out how much power did we achieve in this study. After we compute the post hoc power analysis, I'm going to show you how to do an a priori power analysis. It's the a priori power analysis that allows us to pick the power level that we want. And then we're able to figure out how many people or things would we need to measure to achieve that power level. Both types of power analyses are important, but really it's that a priori power analysis that's so important because before we even begin a study, we can determine how many people would we need to measure to have sufficient power. Let's not get ahead of ourselves. Let's talk about that post hoc power analysis. And just look at that terminology, post hoc. Post means after. So we would compute a post hoc power analysis after we've already collected data. So let's figure out what power level did we achieve in that research study. Let's compute a post hoc power analysis. In order to compute a post hoc power analysis, we first need to compute delta. This is the symbol for delta right here. It's also known as the non-centrality parameter. Computing delta is really pretty easy. And it makes power analysis easy for us, because once we have that delta value, we can look up that value in a power table, and then we know how much power we achieved. The only thing that I think is confusing at this point is that delta, which is the non-centrality parameter, is kind of similar looking to Cohen's d. And remember, Cohen's d is a measurement of effect size. And they are in the same equation, because when we compute delta, delta is actually based on the effect size, Cohen's d, and our sample size, n. So, of course, it's important that we don't confuse the two. As I mentioned, in order to compute delta, we need to know the effect size, Cohen's d, and sample size. Let's make sure we can find that information. Sample size is easy. We look up here, we look at the basic summary of the research study, and we can see that 10 research participants were measured. So we know that the sample size, n, equals 10. And we already computed the effect size. We'll recompute it real quickly just to make sure we remember. But right down here was the effect size. Let's just walk through the computations again just to make sure we remember, because when we go through examples later on, we'll be computing effect size again from scratch. You might recall that Cohen's d is a measurement of effect size that is standardized, because ultimately it tells us how big the differences are that we actually observed in standard deviation units. So in this case, the numerator can be found right here, because we see that the people who were medicated, it took them 225 milliseconds on average to respond. And people who are not medicated, in general, it takes them about 200 milliseconds to respond. So the people who were medicated, it took them longer to respond. Let's calculate that difference. We'll take 225 and then subtract 200. So the numerator for Cohen's d is 25. And now we want to standardize that difference by dividing by the standard deviation. And right up here in the information about the research study, we see the standard deviation when it comes to people's reaction times is equal to 32.66. So I divide by 32.66. And we find that Cohen's d equals about 0.77. That means the difference that we observed between the medicated people and the unmedicated people was somewhere around 3/4 of a standard deviation. That's a relatively large effect. Once we know the value of Cohen's d, and we know the sample size, it's very easy to compute delta. Let's just walk through it. We'll just take it one step at a time. For the first step, let's figure out the square root of the sample size. In other words, let's figure out the square root of 10. So I'm going to type in 10, and then I'm going to hit my square root key. That equals about 3.16. So for the next step, let's take 0.77 and multiply by 3.16. That equals about 2.43. It's that easy to compute the non-centrality parameter. It's that easy to compute delta. And now we have a handy-dandy power table that makes it easy to figure out the power we actually achieved in this study. All we need to do is look up 2.43 in our power table. This is just a little snapshot of part of the power table. What we want to do is find this column that's labeled delta, and then find the closest value to 2.43. The closest value would be 2.40. Now we need to look over and find the right column. For that t-test, we did a two-tailed test with an alpha of 0.05. So I'm just going to come down right here, and the value that I see is 0.67. That is the power that we achieved through this study. Remember, anytime we compute something, we want to interpret it to make sure we understand it. So in this case, based on Cohen's d, which is our effect size, based on n, which is our sample size, based on alpha, which determined how much evidence we needed to reject the null hypothesis, we're finding that we'd have a 67% chance of rejecting that null hypothesis, of course, when it's false, when there really is an effect, based on our data. In other words, we'd have a 67% chance of finding statistically significant differences when indeed they do exist. 67% is roughly 2/3. So what that's telling us is, with a power level of 0.67 or 67%, about 2/3 of the time, we would be successful in finding statistically significant results when differences really do exist. That's not terrible, but it also doesn't meet the minimum power standard that we discussed before, and that's 80%. With a minimum power standard of 80%, we would find statistically significant differences that really do exist about 80% of the time over the long run. So this is what I want to do next. Next, I want to compute an a priori power analysis. Let's assume that we wanted to run this study again, or let's assume we were running this study for the very first time and we hadn't started yet. We want to figure out how many people would we need to measure. In other words, what would our sample size need to be so that we would have a power level of 80%? So that we don't confuse an a priori power analysis with a post hoc power analysis, go ahead and draw a line over here. Draw a line and separate the two on the page. Because what we're going to do right now is focus on that a priori analysis. For an a priori power analysis, you can see that we're solving for the sample size, n, but that formula still consists of the same three basic components. So we have n, the sample size, we have delta, which is the non-centrality parameter, and we have Cohen's d, which is a measurement of effect size. We already computed the effect size. That was equal to 0.77. Now, we want to consult our power table and figure out the value of delta to enter in. And remember, we want to have 80% power. So I'm going to look over here. It says alpha for a two-tailed test. We were using an alpha of 0.05 for the t-test. So we're going to want to look at the 0.05 column. And now I want to come down and look at these power levels. I want to figure out how many people I need to measure to have power equal to 80%. So I'm going to look for the closest thing to 80%. And right here is 0.80. Now I can just come across here and figure out what delta value is associated with 80% power. And the delta value is 2.80. So in our formula, we'd enter 2.80 in our numerator. Now let's just crunch the numbers and figure out our sample size. You can see according to the formula, we have to take this fraction, compute it, and then square it. So let's take that fraction. We'll start with the numerator, 2.80. And then we will divide by 0.77. That equals 3.64 approximately. Now remember, when we're doing this together, I like to take it one step at a time and I just round a little bit along the way. It makes it easier for all the students to follow. So we'll round that to 3.64 and then we'll square it. Remember, this is sample size. I can't have 13.25 people in my sample. So we're just going to round that up to the nearest full person, the nearest whole number. So in conclusion, this a priori power analysis is telling us that we would need about 14 people in our sample to have about 80% power. So just like that, we've already run two different power analyses. They're really quick and they're really pretty easy. Let's look at that delta table in full. So far, we've just looked at that little snapshot. Let me show you the full delta table just so that we're familiar with it. This is our delta table. I usually just refer to it as a power table. You can find it on our course website, or you can just Google power table or delta table, and you'll probably find something very similar. Just like in the snapshot we were looking at earlier, we can see delta values listed along these rows. And then you can see that these columns are headed with different alpha levels. So as long as we're looking at the right alpha level, and we're looking at the delta value that we computed, we can then figure out how much power we have achieved. Another thing you'll notice is no matter how large the alpha level is, and no matter how large the delta value is, you're still never going to see a power level above 0.99. And that's because if we are collecting data from a sample, remember, we're collecting incomplete information. We don't have information from the entire population. So there's always at least some possibility, some small probability, that we're making a type 2 error. Let's go through another set of examples. We'll first compute a post hoc power analysis, and then we'll compute an a priori power analysis. We'll just change some of the numbers so we can get a little bit more practice. Let's first compute a post hoc power analysis. And this time, let's assume that the effect size is quite a bit smaller. So in this case, Cohen's d is equal to 0.15. That's a relatively small effect. But this time, let's also assume that the sample size is larger. We'll assume this time that the sample size is 100. Let's think about what we need to do. In order to compute a post hoc power analysis, we need to figure out a value for delta. We've already run the study. We already have a value for our sample size. What we need to figure out is how much power did we achieve? After we collected the data, we computed the effect size and it equals 0.15. So we put that right there in our formula. And then we remind ourselves that in our research study, we collected data from 100 people. So our sample size n is equal to 100. Now, of course, the square root of 100 is 10. So we get to the next step pretty easily. Let's go ahead and pull out our calculator and then compute our delta value. According to our formula, we need to take 0.15 and then multiply that by 10. I guess that was pretty easy as well. That equals a delta value of 1.5. Now we need to consult our power table and we'll look up a delta value of 1.5. And remember, we were using an alpha of 0.05 for a two-tailed test. Here's our power table. Here's a delta value of 1.5. I want to move across until I see the column labeled 0.05 for a two-tailed test. And right there, I see my power level, 0.32. I hope that you would agree that that's a pretty crappy power level. Here would be a good interpretation. Based on Cohen's d, which is the effect size, based on our sample size, which was 100, and based on our alpha level, which was 0.05 for a two-tailed test, we would only have a 32% chance of rejecting the null hypothesis with our data. That is horrible. Why would you want to embark on a study where you have such a low probability of being successful? I assume you wouldn't. That's what makes the a priori power analysis so important. Before you actually begin your study, before you actually start collecting data, you run the a priori power analysis to figure out what sample size you would need for the power level that you are comfortable with. So go ahead, draw a line right here. We'll want to separate the post hoc power analysis that we just computed from the a priori power analysis that we're about to compute right now. Let's assume that we want power equal to 85%. We want to have an 85% chance of finding statistically significant differences when indeed they do exist. Remember, when we're doing an a priori power analysis, we're trying to figure out what sample size we need. So the formula that we need should start with n, and you can see that this formula does. We are going to enter an effect size of 0.15. In reality, researchers usually need to estimate that value. If they haven't run the study yet, they don't really know what the size of the effect is. But keep this in mind as well. There's lots of research being conducted out there. Lots of times people are doing minor variations of a study that's been done in the past. So oftentimes, even though you need to estimate the effect size, you have a pretty good sense of what it probably is. So in this case, we are going to assume that Cohen's d equals 0.15. In other words, we're assuming it's a relatively small effect. What we need to do right now is consult our power table and figure out what delta value is associated with power of 85%. So here we are back at our power table. Remember, we're doing a two-tailed test with an alpha of 0.05. I want to come down here now and find the closest thing to 85%. And there's 85% right there. Now I just want to figure out what delta value is associated with that power level. And it's a delta value of 3. Here we are back at our formula. You can see that we need to compute that fraction that consists of that delta value over our effect size. So I'll enter in 3, which is the delta value, divide by our effect size, 0.15. That gives us a value of 20. According to our formula, we need to square that. So I hit the square button, and our final answer is that n equals 400. So in other words, if we're going to have an 85% chance of finding statistically significant differences, when indeed they do exist, we would need to have approximately 400 subjects. That's a relatively large number. Remember, this was a research study where the research participants were driving virtual cars to see how fast they could react to various obstacles. That's the type of research study that really takes some time to carry out. Now imagine having to run that research study with 400 different participants. That's going to take a long time. And you know what? It might cost a lot of money. That might be one reason that some researchers don't compute a priori power analyses. They might be afraid of what they're going to find out. But you know, the ugly truth is, if you want to have a high power level and you're chasing after a relatively small effect size, you're going to need lots of data to find a statistically significant result. But it's all good. We're not afraid. In the next video, we're going to do an a priori power analysis and a post hoc power analysis, but in that case, we're going to be doing it for an independent samples t-test. I'll see you in that next video. In the meantime, be safe.